So this video is going to cover lab safety and tools. Okay, some things we're going to use in our classroom. So let me just get this thing set up and then we'll take off. All right. So when it comes to lab safety, all right, I know our labs are going to be slightly different this year. So I'm actually going to add something to our video while we or to our PowerPoint while we go through this. But when it comes to lab safety, a couple of things that we want to keep in mind. If we're within 6 feet, we've got to have masks on. That will just be something additional that we utilize this year. Also, if you use a tool, we're going to wipe it down just to make sure that we don't have any contact issue. Okay, so let's look at a couple of things for lab safety. So obviously, I'm going to give you the safety contract. You'll read it, sign it, return it, all that good stuff. But the big thing about lab safety is some of the things that we use in here are dangerous. We want to make sure that we're safe around them. We don't put other people at risk. Also, some of the equipment that we use is expensive, and we definitely don't want to damage any equipment. Okay, so make sure that we are safe in the lab. So a couple just general outline things. Be responsible. You're young adults. We're not out here to horseplay. We're not doing practical jokes. We're not playing pranks. Don't mess around in the lab. If I tell you to do something, do it. If you don't understand it, put your hand up and ask, okay? We never work by ourselves in the lab. If you have to make up a lab or something like that, I have to be here. If there's a sub, you don't do lab with a sub. You only do lab with me, okay? I do teach chemistry and also AP chemistry, so sometimes there'll be things in the lab that are for their classes. Don't touch things unless I tell you to touch them, right? Okay, not everything in the lab is for biology, all right? And kind of with that, don't go out and be like, oh, you know, I'm just going to mix these two things. Like, oh, yeah. No, don't do that. Okay. It's not a good idea. We don't eat in the lab because of the social distancing, you know, guidelines that we're using. There are some desks that are currently in the lab. If you're in those desks, you cannot eat in them. They're too close to the lab. Okay. Always have your pre-lab done. Or read the lab prep if there is no pre-lab before you get here. We want to know what we want to do. I'll make sure that it's a well-ventilated area. I'll, you know, open the windows up or we'll use the fume hood if we need to, okay? Keep your work area clean. Don't let it get nasty, okay? And make sure that, you know, you're watching out for the people around you. If there are chemicals that we use, check with me for how to dispose of them. Don't just dump things down the sink. Okay, that can get us into a tremendous amount of trouble, and it can also be dangerous. And from an environmental perspective, that is the absolute last thing that we want to do. So don't just dump things down the sink. You're going to have goggles on anytime you're in the lab. Don't touch your face. Like, I shouldn't have to say that, but, you know, I have had instances where, you know, kids wipe their mouth or something like that, and I'm like, hey, you know, be glad that we're not using a chemical because you could have gotten it in your mouth, right? So don't you know, touch your face. That's a good idea. Anytime we finish a lab, before you eat, wash your hands with soap and water. Don't leave your experiments just unattended, right? Don't wander off. Don't talk to other people about theirs. Just do your work, okay? In the classroom, we will talk about where the fire blankets are, where the showers are, where the eye wash is, where the first aid kit is, all that good stuff. So we know about that. We have two exits for the room. And if it got real bad, I guess three, we could go out a window, but we'd like to not do that, right? If there is a fire drill during lab, make sure that all of your electrical things are turned off. If you're using a Bunsen burner or something like that, that it's turned off. You know, you just flip the off switch and we're good to go, okay? Don't leave things in the lab unattended. So if there's a fire drill or something like that, we need to cut off our experiments. If we're having a lab day, okay, you have to have safety goggles on. If you have long hair, like I have long hair, it's got to be pulled back like this, okay? If we're using fire or something like that, you'll all get a good chuckle, but you'll see me take my beard, I'll wrap it up and usually tuck it into my shirt and get it out of the way, all right? If you have rings, things like that, you need to take them off. If you are wearing like loose jewelry, put that off in your, put it in your bag. Don't wear baggy clothing on days of lab or days that we have lab. And I always give you a heads up before we have a lab. But, you know, If you wear like the puffy pirate shirts, right, like the big flowy arms, those would probably not be a good thing for lab day. Always want to wear closed-toed shoes on lab day in case two things. Number one, if chemicals spill, that would be, you know, obviously bad if you're wearing flip-flops or something like that. Also, though, if someone knocks over a glass and that glass is hot, like if we've been heating a glass, or if we're heating glass and it shatters, which happens on occasion, we don't want hot glass to get on your foot, okay? So we always wear closed-toed shoes. If you wear contact lenses, just let me know. There, I don't have any labs planned where that should be an issue, but some contact lenses are not the best things to wear in a lab where there is the production of gas, okay? So just give me a heads up if you're wearing contacts. Now, if there is an accident, if you spill something, if you break something, if you get cut, right, if there's an injury, if you burn yourself, just tell me, all right? It doesn't matter if it's really minor. It doesn't matter if it's really bad. I'm not going to get mad. Just let me know what's going on so that I can help you. If your lab partner gets hurt, get my attention. Now, it says yell. Don't yell. Just loudly get my attention, right? Don't panic. Just roadnizer. Like, that's all you really need to do, okay? If you get something in your eye because you don't have your goggles on, which is not allowed, but if you get something in your eye, you have to wash it out for 20 minutes, according to OSHA, the Occupational Safe and Healthy Standard, Health Standards, in the eye wash. So I'll help you with that. So you got to let me know you got something in your eye. If we are handling things in the lab, just general kind of guidelines, treat everything like it's a dangerous toxin, right? Don't touch it, taste it, smell it, unless I tell you to do so. If you treat it like it's dangerous, you'll be fine. If I have a bunch of chemicals out and I'm like, okay, you're going to get some of this and some of this and some of this, follow your lab print, go. I'm going to let you guys do those labs. Read the label, okay? Don't get a bunch of extra. If it says 2 grams, get 2 grams. Don't get 6, okay? The reason for that is we don't put unused chemicals back into the container. Once you take it out, it's contaminated, so we don't use it or we don't put it back in there. Don't ever take anything out of my lab, right? That's pretty standard. If we have living things in the lab, which we're not planning on this year, but if we did, we'll treat them in a humane way, okay? And if we did like a dissection, like a preserved material, we're going to treat them with respect as well, okay? So we want to be responsible and, you know, mature in the lab. As far as glassware, if something breaks, you don't mess with it. I'll clean it up, okay? I'll use a brush and a dustpan. Don't touch broken things. Before you use something, examine stuff for chips. So like this is a beaker. It does have a very slight chip right here. It's kind of hard to see on the screen, but there is a very slight chip in there. I wouldn't use that, okay, if I were you doing an experiment. Now, I'll use it because I use this beaker for one specific thing, but we definitely don't want to heat glassware with chips or anything like that, okay? If it's dirty, which right now this is pretty dirty, wash it out before you use it, okay? There's, you know, 8-10 sinks in my classroom, 11 sinks in my classroom. So wash out glassware before you use it. If you don't know how to use something, ask. I'll talk you through it. If you do heat glassware, don't stick it in cold water. It'll shatter. It's not made for that, okay? When you pull an electrical plug out of something, so if you're heating or if you're using a microscope, okay, grab it by the plug and pull it out of the socket. Don't grab it down here on the wire and like yank on it, okay? That'll mess up the plug, okay? So don't do that, all right? If you are carrying a microscope, use both hands. So there's an arm and a base. You should have a hand on the arm and a hand on the base, and we carry it close to our body. We're not out here dangling around like a lunchbox, okay? This is expensive, so take care of it. If you're heating something, make sure your hair, your clothes, your hands are away from the hot plate, all right? Glass stays hot, so just because you took it off the heat a couple minutes ago doesn't mean it's automatically cooled down, all right? Use the beaker tongs to pick things up, and we'll look at those. And if you absolutely have to, I do have some gloves, but we won't heat anything that hot in biology. If you're heating something, don't look in it, right? So if I'm heating this, I can look at it this way, that's fine. I don't want to do this. This would be bad, right? Because stuff coming up out of the container can get in my eyes. That's not good. And finally, We have what's called wire gauze in the lab benches. If you heat something, you sit it on the wire gauze. You don't sit it directly down on the cold desk. Okay. Now, let's talk about some of the things that we might end up using in the lab. Number one, this is a beaker. Okay. I'm only going to show you three actual pieces of equipment in my hand, but the pictures on here are representative of those things. So a beaker is used to hold liquids. It's not used for measuring. Okay. You can see right here on the increments, it says plus or minus 5%. That's not a very accurate tool for measuring, right? So, you know, if I have 100 milliliters in here, well, I might have 105 and I might have, you know, 95. Like I could be plus or minus 5%. So that's bad. We never, ever, ever measure with a beaker. It's just to hold or mix liquid. Same thing with bottles or test tubes. Test tubes don't even have these tick marks or declinations on the side. So, you know, we don't measure things with a test tube. We do sometimes heat test tubes. Don't put a stopper in the end when it's heated, and you always want to tilt it away from other people and yourself. Now, this is an Erlenmeyer flask. You can use it to measure if it's an accurate flask. It'll say on the side whether or not it is. I only have a couple of those. Normally, we don't measure in quantities with Erlenmeyer flasks. We use them for mixing. So you hold it by the top and you swirl it. Okay. Now, measuring is done with a graduated cylinder. Okay. This is an extremely accurate, measuring tool. You look at it at the meniscus, which is, you know, the midpoint of the curve of the liquid that's in there. Okay. So if we're doing density, we're using a graduated cylinder to measure the volume. Okay. We always measure with the graduated cylinder. Okay. This little thing right here actually has two purposes. Number one, if you are pouring something into it and you spill a little bit, this should catch it. All right. You want this opening to be near the lip of the beaker. The other thing is if it falls, it will land on the plastic and not on the glass. All right. So if I see it like this, it's not doing any good. Fix it. All right. This goes at the top, all right, above the tick marks. This comes off. Be careful. Make sure that it's well seated, okay, that it's down on there. And you don't want it to be crooked, right? So you can see right there that it's crooked. That would be a bad measurement. So we just make sure it's seated, give it a little tap, right? And that's it. We use burettes in chemistry, so we're not going to talk about those for biology. We do have pipettes and micropipettes for very small quantities. We have one lab where we use those. For heating, we use Bunsen burners. So we have gas in the room. We'll talk a lot about gas safety. But the Bunsen burner uses the gas. We also have hot plates, which are, you know, they look like little ovens. You stitch your beaker on top and you heat it. A water bath is just a way to keep test tubes at a constant temperature. It's water that's been heated to a certain temperature and it's staying there. You put your test tubes in it and get to that temperature. We use petri dishes to grow bacteria, among other things, yeast, that kind of stuff. We often just call them plates. All right, so if you hear the word plate, that means petri dish. This picture here on the slide is a petri dish. And so if you put something in a petri dish, we say we've plated it. So that's where you might hear those two words. We do have some incubators. They are like little ovens that, you know, keep those plates at the ideal temperature for whatever it is we're trying to grow. So usually we use body temperature, which is about 37 degrees Celsius. For dissection, I don't know that we'll be able to do a dissection this year. We generally leave that for Bio2. But in the event that we did, we might end up using things like scissors, scalpels, pins, tweezers, and a pan. The pan is what it sits in. I think everybody knows what tweezers are. Pins, you actually like pin down the specimen. A scalpel, this is a scalpel, very, very sharp. Be careful with them if we use them. Always carry them down. You know, when you cut with them, you cut away from other people. Okay. We don't use any electron microscopes, but I want you to know what an electron microscope is. Okay, there's two kinds. There's an SEM and a TEM, scanning electron microscope, and a tunneling or transmission electron microscope. Okay, it uses electrons instead of light. We talked about that in another video, but basically, they give us pictures that look like this. Okay, so this one on the left, on the top left, is a light microscope, okay, of a paramecium. On the right, we have this another paramecium, but we see that with the scanning electron microscope, we get a good view of the surface with great detail. We can see all the little cilia, all the little hairs that it kind of beats against the water to swim around, okay? And then if we look at the difference in magnification, the light microscope goes up to about 110 magnification. The scanning electron microscope is at 1,500, all right, as far as magnification. So definitely a whole lot better resolution there. This tunneling or transmission electron microscope is at 60,000, okay? And you can actually see this is where each of those hairs fits into the cytoplasm. And you can see there's a mitochondria, some organelles in the cell itself. So definitely big difference between those three. Here's some other things. This is a grain of pollen with a scanning electron microscope. This is a mote of dust, right? A mote is a small piece of dust, okay? Notice that there's color in these images. These are false color images. Color is always added to scanning electron microscopes. They always show up in black and white, so you can see the color there. Now, optical microscopes are what we use. They are simple and compound microscopes just based on the number of lenses they have, and they use light, okay? For a simple magnifying glass, that would be a simple microscope, okay? It's got a single lens or a very small set of lenses close to each other, and you just kind of move the microscope back and forth in order to, you know, get your focus. For a compound microscope, we have what's called an objective and then an ocular piece or an eyepiece, okay? So ocular means eye. If you have a monocular microscope, it has one tube with the eye, like you look through one tube. If it's binocular, which is what we have, it looks like this. So this would be a binocular set. These are the ocular pieces, okay? They're where you put your eyes, you look down in here. Down here we have the objectives, which are also lenses, and they rotate on what we call the nose piece, okay? This is the arm, the base is down here at the bottom, okay? And this can be moved back and forth in order to help people in your group see. You separate these two things to help, you know, to where they fit with your, you know, distance between your eyes. Most research, like it says on the slide, most research microscopes have two. Now, the magnification of your microscope depends on the two lenses that you have, okay? So the problem with that is with a light microscope, you can keep zooming and keep zooming and keep zooming, but eventually things just get bigger, but you don't get any more detail out of it, okay? And that's called resolution. So a better microscope actually doesn't have just really good magnification. It also has really good, it has to have really good resolution to be a high quality microscope. So magnification to over like 2000 are usually blurry because the light beam that you're passing through gets scattered. You can't see anything. So there is a limit to what a light microscope can resolve. That's what that's called. Now, when you're trying to figure out magnification, we always can assume, it's usually written on there, like on this one it is, that the ocular is 10x, so it increases the magnification by 10. And then the nose piece down here, these objective lenses all have a number on them. So like this is the 4x, this is the 10x, this is the 40x, and the oil immersion is actually 100x. And in order to figure out your total magnification, you just multiply whatever's on here times 10, because 10 here times 4, so that would give me a 40x view. If I did 10 times 10, that'd be 100x. I don't have a 20 lens on this one, but I do have a 40, so 10 times 40 is a 400x. And this is an oil immersion lens. It gives you 10 up here times 100, so 1,000x, 1,000 magnification. We do have oil immersion lenses, so we can see up to 1,000 in the classroom. Notice these are red. Make sure you know all these parts, okay? Could end up on a quiz. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge, okay? When we take care of our microscopes, we always carry them with two hands. We use lens paper for cleaning. I have some lens paper here. It has a big picture of a microscope on it, and it says optical lens paper suitable for microscopes. So there it is. Don't use the blue piece at the front. Just use the white pieces. Okay, they're nice and thin and good. Don't ever touch the lens right to the specimen or the slide. And if you turn in a knob and it stops, stop. Don't force it. Okay. Well, you always start with the 4X piece. Okay, get it where you can see it. Center what you want to look at, and then you know you turn your objectives until you get the view you want. Okay. We will do a wet mount in here. We'll take a slide. We'll put something on it. Add a drop of water, and we'll use what's called a cover slip, and we'll just kind of lower it over the edge, okay? And we'll talk about that in class, right? If we, or when we get to that. Okay, so that's safety and microscopes and all that good stuff. If you have, let me move this microscope so I can see. If you have questions, shoot me an email, all right? Keep working, and that's it for lab safety and tools.